Nacional de Colposcopía de Panamá, en Santiago de Veraguas, tiene el honor con la visita del científico Lou Gießmann, quien fue director del Centro Alemán de Investigación del Cáncer, División, Modificaciones Genómicas y Carcinogénesis.
First, I wanted to thank Dr. Potassi for his invitation to Panama, and I would like to congratulate you, Ramon, you and your team for the excellent setting you have developed here, and I think this is very, very helpful and will be a good service for the people in Panama, especially for women in Panama.
Los descubrimientos realizados por el Dr. Gießmann sobre el papilomavirus humano en la década del 70 y 80 ha sido un aporte valiosísimo a la humanidad, por medio de los cuales ha habido un conocimiento sobre su genoma e historia natural, hasta llegar al escenario de las vacunas profilácticas y terapéuticas, siendo una innovación efectiva en la prevención del cáncer cervicouterino. A continuación, el Dr. Gießmann hará referencia de los primeros estudios científicos sobre el papilomavirus.
The infectious origin of cervical cancer is known since the middle of the 19th century already. However, at this time, the nature of this infectious agent, the virus or the bacterium, was not known. It took approximately another 150 years before this responsible agent was discovered, which is the human papillomavirus. How this human papillomavirus came into discussion was based on observations which have been known at the time that certain papillomavirus induced warts in humans in the genital tract can progress into malignant cancer, and also it has been well described at the time already that papillomaviruses in certain animals act as carcinogens in the natural host, and meaning upon infection of the animals with this papillomavirus, cancer, malignant cancer arises. It was essential for the discovery of the responsible agents for cervical cancer that the family of papillomaviruses was studied in more detail than it had been done before that time in the 70s, 80s of the last century. Well, it became apparent relatively quickly that this is a whole big family of papillomaviruses in humans, and the individual members are called papillomavirus types, HPV types. We know nowadays that we have more than 200 different HPV types. Among them is a group of so-called high-risk papillomaviruses, HPV 16, HPV 18, 31, 33, and approximately 10 others, which are responsible for the development of cervical cancer. A large study worldwide has revealed that more than 99% of cervical cancer in humans are induced by one of the so-called high-risk papillomavirus types. In addition, we know nowadays that not only cervical cancer, but also a substantial fraction of other anogenital cancer, cancer of the penis, the vulva, the perineum, are caused by papillomaviruses, and most recently it became clear that approximately 30 to 50% of head and neck cancer in adults, males and females, are caused by human papillomaviruses. Besides this variety of diseases which can be induced by HPV, the most important in terms of number is cervical cancer, and this is also the reason why this scenario is best studied and is best known to us. We know today pretty much about the natural history of HPV and the development of cervical cancer. So it is known that 60 to 80% of sexually active individuals, males and females, contract the papillomavirus infection. In the majority of cases, 90% or even more, these infections remain transient, virus is replicated, and then the infection vanishes spontaneously by the interference of the immune system. In approximately 10% of cases, however, these infections become chronic, become persistent, and on the basis of this persistent infection, precursor lesions may develop, which then eventually may progress into malignant cancer. At the end of the day, approximately 1% of the infected women will develop cervical cancer decades later after the primary infection, and meaning that this is a very inefficient process. However, this must not be forgotten, although the relative risk is very low, the absolute risk, the absolute numbers are very high. We have approximately 500,000 cervical cancer cases worldwide every year. 85% of them arise in the so-called developing world. Fortunately, it is possible to prevent cervical cancer by a procedure which has been nominated or has been called Pap screening. What this means is that cells are exfoliated from the uterine cervix and then they are examined microscopically for changes. And once such changes have been identified, the lesion is treated, therefore progression is prevented. More recently, the detection of HPV in such exfoliated cells have been put forward, and it's now a big discussion what is preferential, either the Pap smear or the HPV test. Well, the HPV testing certainly has the advantage of being more sensitive, meaning that less cases are being missed. However, the cost for such an assay is higher. There's another option for screening, and this is colposcopy, which has been developed to perfection by Dr. Potasio, and I think he will dwell on that in more detail.
La colposcopía es base fundamental del programa de cáncer intestinal. En nuestro instituto desarrollamos colposcopía avanzada, que consiste en la evaluación del tracto genital inferior, concepto acuñado por el Dr. Enrique Coscolillo a principios de los años 90, y que consiste en la evaluación de cervix, vagina y vulva. A través de esta metodología podemos hacer los diagnósticos oportunos y evitando que los pacientes avancen a los cánceres invasores. Por medio de la colposcopía podemos detectar las lesiones en el cuello del útero tempranamente, las cuales habitualmente son producidas por los virus de alto riesgo y que pueden llegar a un cáncer cervicuterino. Además, también puede detectar las lesiones exofíticas, tipo verrugas, que se presentan habitualmente en vulva, vagina y área perianal, que son originadas por los virus tipo C y 11. La historia natural de estas lesiones está bien descrita, algo que el Dr. Gisman nos va a ampliar en este momento.
Well, if we talk about carcinogenesis, the induction of tumors by papillomaviruses, we must first of all consider the normal life cycle of these viruses, because it has to be stressed that the induction of cancer, the development of cancer after an infection by papillomaviruses, is not only an accident, obviously, for the host, for the woman, but also for the virus, and I try to explain that in the following. Papillomaviruses, upon infection of the epithelium, replicate in this tissue to a large number of new virus particles, and this is important for the virus to survive, because the new particles will then find new cells, either in the same individual or in the new recipient. So this is the normal situation. under certain circumstances, and we don't really understand what is the reason for that, but under certain circumstances, depending on the site of infection and depending on the HPV type, this infection can become chronic, meaning that the virus persists for a long time, probably lifelong, somewhere in the epithelium, in the lower cells of the epithelium, without doing any visible damage to the host. So the infected person does not realize typically that he or she is infected. Well, as this persistence takes on for a long time, then slowly the virus production gets lower and lower. So it's less and less virus particles. However, at the same time, certain viral proteins are expressed to a high degree in the infected epithelium. These so-called oncogenes, oncoproteins, trigger mutations within the infected epithelium, which then, as a long and inefficient process over many years and in the minority of cases, can develop into cancer.
Está descrito que la mayoría de las lesiones por papilomavirus pueden tener regresión, como mencionó el doctor Bisman. Sin embargo, el papilomavirus continúa siendo una carga importante ante el cáncer cervical. Cada año a nivel mundial se presentan aproximadamente 530.000 casos nuevos de cáncer cervical, de los cuales van a morir 270.000 el mismo año. Es preocupante que el 85% de los casos se presenta en los países en vía de desarrollo como el nuestro, siendo un problema de salud pública. Frente a esta realidad, surge la elaboración de una vacuna contra el papilomavirus como nueva estrategia. Para esto, el doctor Kisman nos describirá sus inicios, bases, efectos secundarios, presente y futuro de esta vacuna.
The concept of HPV vaccines, of the HPV vaccines, was based on observations in animals, experimental studies in animals, but also on observations in individuals, in humans. So it has been demonstrated that pre-immunization protects against reinfection by the same virus. And this was conveyed, this effect was conveyed by the induction of so-called neutralizing antibodies that are very specific to a papilloma virus. So it was clear from the beginning that an effective prophylactic vaccine must induce such neutralizing antibodies. Today, we have three different HPV vaccines on the market, which have been developed around the turn of the century, and have been introduced since 2006. The results which have been obtained from the clinical studies and also of the introduction into populations, different populations in different countries, are the following. One, the vaccines are extremely immunogenic. That means they induce neutralizing antibodies even after two or even after a single shot of immunization. Most likely, this immunity remains lifelong. Second, the vaccines are almost 100% effective. That means that close to 100% of infections and diseases derived therefrom by this particular papillomavirus are prevented by vaccination. Three, and most important, very important, there are no side effects, no serious side effects by these vaccines, as far as we can tell now. It has been demonstrated repeatedly that there are slight pain and swelling at the site of infection, but this is normal and also expected if we have the activation of the immune system. The very rare cases of severe side effects, such as neurological symptoms, have never been identified as causal, but they are rather coincidental in times. So it is clear that these vaccines are extremely safe and no harm is made if one receives them. On the other hand, as I mentioned before, they are extremely effective and will in the future, if applied systematically, save many, many lives. As far as the future of vaccine research is concerned, it will be important to tailor the application schedule in the population to the situation in this particular country. Second, it will be important also to introduce the vaccine to boys, because not only do the men transmit the virus, but they are by themselves victims of this infection. For instance, they can develop cancer of the penis, of the perineum, and also of the head and neck. And last not least, and this has been neglected a little bit in the past, is the developing of so-called therapeutic vaccines. That means that one should develop a vaccine which also benefits those individuals, males and women, which do not, have not received the vaccine at the first place for whatever reasons. This is ongoing research and hopefully we will have some results in the near future. Let me thank now Dr. Potasio for the invitation and I want to congratulate him and his team for an excellent setting to service the population in Panama.
El Instituto Nacional de Colposcopía y todo el recurso humano que labora en él agradece al Dr. Lukisman su presencia en el fortalecimiento de los programas de prevención que desarrollamos referente a la educación, referente a lo que es colposcopía avanzada y vacunación en Panamá. Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. Thank you.